تبارك الله رب العالمين.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله، الحمد لله الذي جعل ذكره طمأنينة للقلوب وجلاء لها نارين الذنوب ومطردة لوسواس الخناس المكذوب، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد الداعي إلى كل فعل محبوب وأمر مطلوب، وعلى آله وأصحابه المقتفين سبيله على خير أسلوب. أما بعد، فيقول رب تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المنزل: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا وسبحوه بكرة وأصيلا، هو الذي يصلي عليكم وملائكته ليخرجكم من الظلمات إلى النور وكان بالمؤمنين رحيما. تحيتهم يوم يلقونه سلام وأعد لهم أجرا كريما. وقال تعالى: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. صدق الله العظيم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O ye who believe, remember Allah in abundance and exalt Him morning and evening, sing His praise, say His praise. It is He who confers blessings, rahmah, mercy upon you, and His angels ask Him to do so that He may bring you out of darkness into the light. And ever He is to the believers all merciful. Their greeting on the day they meet Him will be as-salam, salam, peace. And He has prepared for them an abode of reward. Today, in our 35th lesson on improving khushu', improving the quality of our salah, we continue from last week where we spoke about the importance of tashahhud. We moved from sajda into the position of tashahhud, which I said was to assume the position, the form of hay'atul 'abdi bayna yaday sayyidihi. It is the position of a slave in front of his master. Sitting in tashahhud is not a place, it is not a springboard for your plunge back into your worldly deeds, your worldly grind, your daily excitements and your daily chores, as we tend to do in salah. Salah is not to be seen, is tashahhud, as a wrapping up of your prayer and I'm finishing off, so I just do this quickly and move on. It is not a springboard for which you pop back from where you once come and you are now popping out, and salah is just to, the tashahhud is just to top it off and finish it quickly. And for that I am reminded of the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he saw a sahaba reciting tashahhud quickly. He said to him, Ajilta, ya ajilta ayyuhal musalli, ajilta. This is a sentence we have to remember, that you're praying it too quickly. You're rushing, you're praying, you're rushing, you're sitting. When you sit, he said, Ajilta ayyuhal musalli, that oh, you're running fast. Why are you doing it so quickly? And then when he said that, because that person came in, he was sitting in the mosque, and a person came in and prayed, and he said, Allahumma ghfirli warhamni, and he finished it. He finished his sitting in tajahud quickly, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam noticed it. And he said that, إِذَا صَلَّيْتَ, he said, when you sit, فَقَعَدْتَ, he said, when you pray and then you sit, when you sit down now, فَحْمَدِ اللَّهَ بِمَا هُوَ أَهْلُهُ, then you should thank Allah with what He is deserving, with what He is deserving of. And what he is deserving of is those special words that Rasulullah ﷺ taught the Sahaba to do. He said, فَحْمِدِ اللَّهَ بِمَا هُوَ أَهْلُهُ وَصَلِّ عَلَيَّ, and then say salam to me, ثُمَّ دُعُهُ, then ask of Allah. Because dua is accepted when you recite salat ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he was emphasizing the importance of tashahhud, in that I told you that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to give the same importance that he gave to the teaching of Quran to the teaching of tashahhud. He would hold them in the mid, hold their hands in his hand and teach them at-tahiyyatu lillahi was-salawatu. He would give them these, the same level of importance to it. So from this alone, we can see what this is. And I told you about the fact that tashahhud is a culmination of your salah. It's like from one aspect, it is like if this is the entire salah was in preparation for tashahhud. This is how it seems, that you are, when you go in, you bow. When you go in front of any king, you bow, you show reverence, you show respect and deference, and then you sing, then you speak to the king. So now you're speaking, you're addressing Allah directly, and you're saying, At-tahiyyatu lillahi was-salawat. And I said to you that there is haq of Allah. Allah has made this compulsory for you to say this. So you're saying, you're saying words of reverence, salutation, you're saying, At-tahiyyat. All tahiyyatu lillah. Every word of reverence that can exist, it's all for Allah. And then lillahi, Allah alone. And in this lam here is hasr, is giving completeness, comprehensive, that all is for Allah. At-tahiyyatu lillahi was-salawatu wa-t-tayyibat. And I said that these words, each of these, have deep meanings. And in order to anchor your mind in the moment in where you are, and to keep you from drifting into the street. Because as soon as we sit down in tashahhud and starting to read at-tahiyyat, our mind automatically gets pulled. We start to think about what we're going to do next. Oh, I have to meet so-and-so person. I have to find my car. I have to fix something in my home. I have to sort something else out. And those occupations that we're supposed to disconnect from in salah return at that point, because we think we are ending, and now what are we going to do next? And shaitan comes and he does this. He pulls you in all different directions. And living, as I said, in today's world, our mind is completely in a daze because of the constant feed that we get from these devices. You know, 1,000 years ago, Imam Ghazali used a metaphor in order to explain this problem. And he said that, كَرَجُلٍ, he said, it's like a man who is sitting تَحْتَ شَزَرَةٍ. He's sitting under a tree in a quiet place in order to get him to bring his thought, لِيَصْفُ فِكْرَهُ, that to clear his thoughts and to concentrate on something, to think about something. And then جَاءَتِ الْأَصَافِيرُ, that the birds, sparrows and birds, come into the tree and starts to distract him. And then he picks up a stick and he hits it, and then after a while, he goes back to his thoughts and the birds return. And then that happens over and over. And eventually someone says to him that in order for you to get complete calm and to clear your mind and to be able to do this in this place, what you have to do, the thing to do is to فَقْتَعِ الشَّجَرَةِ, cut the tree. If you cut the tree, then it will not happen. And the bird will not come there to trouble you. Now, this metaphor, this example has come alive now in the modern world, in the pockets of every individual. The birds are tweeting. We have the Twitter and all the likes of the tweeting that are happening all along. This is 1,000-year-old example that has now come to life in the pockets of each individual. So what is the solution? What is Imam Ghazali saying that this man was told? He said, فَقْتَعِ الشَّجَرَةِ, cut this tree. Cut the tree. And the tree that we have that is tweeting in our pockets, even when it's on silence, it's vibrating and we are reminded. And we become so attached to these things that recently they did studies on children and found that their exam results were suffering if they did not have the phone in their bags next to them in exams. In the exam hall, they have to be allowed to take the phone in the exam hall next to them in the in in the bag. They're not opening it, but they must be allowed. And this is what the psychologists have arrived at the conclusion, that the children need the phone to be next to them. If not, if it's left outside the hall, then they will suffer separation anxiety. That the distance will be too far. The separation anxiety will then lead them to thinking that, there's something might have happened, you know. A fear of missing out. The FO, this one, the FU, fear of missing out, the FMO. The fear that something might be happening in which... And what happens is that... So, فَقْتَعِ الشَّجَرَ cut the tree is meaning that you should be in control of your time. And it should not be left open that events are in control of your time. Everything that someone else does, a person eats a cheesecake and that becomes a reason to interrupt your thoughts. That's not how we should live. I'm not saying, and I don't want people to go away with the wrong impression that I'm against technology, that we should not use technology. Yes, we should, but we should be in control of our time. If every time, if we decide that, look, we have given this a certain time, we will open it and we will switch it off and we will not keep it. Because this punctuated intervention into your moment, into your thoughts, into your ability to concentrate, each time that happens, it leaves a lasting effect on your mind. And then that has an accumulative effect of damage, your inability. You become less able to multitask. And this is what the studies have shown, is that the more you multitask, is the less capable you are at multitasking. This is, people who class themselves as heavy multitaskers are unable to multitask than the people who do not multitask. Their performance on multitasking is less, it decreases. Because we weren't designed to function like this. فَقْتَعِ الشَّجَرَ cut the tree. So cutting the tree would mean switching it off so that your mind is not constantly interrupted and you're able to think and concentrate. This is exactly what, if you read the stories of the Sahaba, what did they do? It is exactly the solution that they brought to the problem. One Sahabi, Abu Talha radiallahu anhu, was praying one day in his orchard. And it was a walled orchard. It was very expensive. And he was praying in that, and a bird came and rustled in the tree somewhere, did something. And he lost track of how many rak'at he'd prayed. So what did he do? He went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he explained what happened. He said, look, this tree had affected me. I was in this orchard and this belongs to me. But I'm now giving it to sadaqah. You give it. You give it to whomsoever you will. And they followed on. There's another story in the caliphate of Uthman radiallahu anhu. A man came to him and said the same thing. That I was in my garden and then this bird, I saw the tree and the fruits hanging from the tree caught my attention in prayer. And I became amazed with the level of fruit on my tree. And then I lost count of how much rak'ah I have. Now I want you to take it and give it to sadaqah. Uthman radiallahu anhu sold that for 50,000 dinars. He sold that ghani for. That is how they used to faqta'i shadara. That is how they used to cut the tree. Because they recognized the value of their salah over and above everything else. But today, what happens? We all, in every society of human history, all societies dislike theft. If a person tells you that in some society they aggrandize and they love thieves, they love stealing, you can disbelieve them with a great degree of certainty that this never happens. Because human nature, it is oppressive, it is wrong, and for every oppression that happens, there's a correction that Allah will do. Perfect justice will happen. So if someone steals from you in this world, on the day of judgment, Allah will rectify it, inshallah. He will give you whatever you lose in this world. Then no, if you look for reward from Allah, that look, this person has robbed me, he's stolen from me, he will not get away with it because the scales will be perfect on the day of judgment in front of Allah. No one can hide from Allah. مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ The tiniest atom will be seen, everything. But there's another type of sariqa, there's another type of stealing that is more difficult. And it is the worst type of stealing. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that أسوأ الناس سرقة, that the worst type of thief, the first type of thief among people, الذي يسرق من صلاته, the one who steals from his salah. How do you steal from your salah? لا يتم ركوع, he said three things. لا يتم ركوعها ولا سجودها ولا خشوعها. Three, that he does not complete his ruku', he goes halfway into ruku' and bounce up like a spring. He goes half into sajda and bounce up like a chicken pecking on the ground. But then the third one is more difficult. We can manage that, the physical one we can manage. We can hold ourselves in position in certain ruku'. We can hold ourselves in position in sajda. But when it comes to khushu', that requires work, that requires effort. And the effort is to work on cleansing the mind so that it does not start, as I say, we are discussing tashahhud. And in tashahhud, you are supposed to send salutations on Allah. You are supposed to say the words of reverence. At-tahiyyatu lillahi wassalawatu wattayyibat. And I explained to you the meaning of the multiple meanings of tahiyyat. And if you know the meaning, if you focus on what it means, then it will anchor your mind in the moment. And you will be there. If not, you will be drifted off and saying, oh, well, I'm now back in the car. Before you leave the mosque, you'll be down the road. That is the important thing to recognize. This, to anchor the mind, anchor it in the meaning of what the tongue is saying. Because anyone that babbles something with their tongue without being conscious of what they're saying is our definition of insanity. If a person walks in the street and is saying words without really meaning anything, not knowing what he's saying, that is our, we recognize people's insanity through that. So it is important for us here to know the meaning of this word, of tahiyyat. Tahiyyat means, what is it? Al-baqa. It means that Allah's dominion. It means, he's talking about Allah's al-baqa, al-azama, the greatness of Allah, the eternity, the eternal nature of Allah, dawam, salam. وَأَنْوَاعُ التَّعْضِيمِ كُلِّهَا, and all of the words and descriptions of greatnesses for Allah, at-tahiyyat. And then we went into as-salawat. And in this one, I told you about dua, the ten meanings, al-dua, baraka, maghfira, rahma, thana, tasliya, which is taqweem anil-i'wajaj, silatul abdi bi rabbihi, at-ta'zeem, was-salawatul khams. I'm not going to translate them all, I did most of them last week. But I also said that there is haqq, there is right in the tashahhud that you need to fulfill, that Allah has said. That one is the right of Allah to say at-tahiyyat to Allah, and then there's the right of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to do salam, to do salat ala al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam there. Because that's the second portion. The first portion was to say reverence to Allah, as-salatu at-tahiyyat, and then as-salamu at-tahiyyatu lillahi was-salawatu wat-tayyibatu as-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabi. As-salam on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's debt on us is immense. We owe him for the sacrifices, for the message that he has given us. And in the verse I read to you, Allah is saying that he and the prophets, he and them and the angels, Allah and the angels, that Allah sends salut, Allah sends salam on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the malaika. So, in the first and foremost thing to bear in mind, that when you say assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabiyyu, this is imtithalu amrillahi fil Qur'an. This is obedience to the command, the direct command of Allah in the Qur'an. This is the first thing to bear in mind. That you're doing this and you're saying assalam. In other words, and as I said last week, that the Sahaba used to say assalamu ala Allah, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that no, assalamu huwa Allah, that salam is Allah, huwa Allah, al-Malikul Quddusus Salam, that Allah is salam, from him all purity comes, and oh, he is the one that gives his salam, he's the one that gives salam to everyone else. So the salam of Allah, the protection, the mercy, and the an'am, the bounties and favors of Allah on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, alayka, Rasulullah ﷺ has passed away, but we say assalamu alayka. And this is also important to recognize. Because Rasulullah ﷺ said, sallu alayya fa inna salatakum tablughuni haythu kunt. That the rules of time and space and the physics of distance do not apply when it comes to salat ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It reaches him. He said, say salam on me, tablughuni, that it reaches me, haythu kunt, wherever you are. When you say it, it will reach. Allah has angels that will take it. There's immediate response. It goes straight to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So there is no difference. This is, you're being given the clear understanding of knowing that when you're interested, when you said assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabi, tablughuna haythu kunt, wherever you are, you will get this. وَمَنْ صَلَّى عَلَيَّ صَلَاةً وَاحِدًا. And here is the reward that you need to understand. We need to recognize this, that now I'm going to say one salam on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I'm going to send one salam, one salat I'm going to send, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to reward me. And how is He going to do that? If I say to you that, look, there is some big sheikh that has come to the city, great sheikh, the greatest alim in the world today, has visited Oxford, and he is the most pious, let us go and ask him to make dua for us. Would you not want to do so? Let us ask him to make dua for my children, for my health, for my wealth, for my family. You would want to do so. What about the opportunity to get the angels? The angels, Allah's angels, Allah's special angels. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that if man salla alayya salatan wa'idan, sallallahu alayhi ashran, that Allah will give you salam, Allah will give you mercy, Allah will give you 10 of those that you give. If you say one, Allah will give you 10. So, and with it, it says, ashara salawatin. Sallallahu alayhi ashara salawatin wa hutta anhu ashara khati'atin. And then, so Allah will give you 10 special blessings, and then He will wipe from your slate the 10 sins. 10 sins that you have committed, Allah will wipe those. And not only that, but then there's a third. So there's 30 things that will happen. The third thing is that He will raise you. Yarfa'uhu ashara darajatin. That He will raise you in 10 stages. He will lift you. He will lift your status 10 stages. Now, just by saying once, assalamu alayka ayyuhan nabi wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is the benefit. And there are more, but we are running out of time. I will continue inshallah next week. But the point that we have to bear in mind, that there is haqq of Allah in tashahhud. It is not a springboard to go back into your daily grind and to start planning for your work and your family and your chores in the salah. This is one of the most important aspects of your salah. And to focus on the meaning of what you're actually saying will anchor your mind in the moment of tashahhud. This is the message of today. And remember what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the word of Rasulullah, ajilta ayyuhal musalli, that you are rushing, O worshipper. He said this to the sahaba. Do not rush it. When he saw the one who rushed it in salah, he saw him in the masjid, he said, ajilta ayyuhal musalli, that you are rushing it. Don't. Iza qa'adta, he said, if you sit, then read it properly, read it, say, because these are the benefits that you will get of dua, of the dua that will follow. Because one of the reasons for the acceptance of dua is to have salat ala nabi. When you say salat, salat ala nabi is accepted. It is confirmed, guaranteed, accepted. When you say salat ala nabi, assalamu alayka, you send salutations on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is guaranteed acceptance. So if you start with that, and then you make dua, and then you complete with that, it's sandwiched between the two, Allahu Hayyun Kareem. Allah will not accept one and two and forget the middle and disregard the middle. He will accept it all. Because Allah is Rahman, Allah is Rahim. فَقْطَعِ الشَّجَرَةِ. Cut the tree. And cutting the tree is in taking control of your time. So that your time is not controlled by the moments of the birds, the twitching of the devices, but you alone are in control of your time, because you alone will stand in front of Allah to answer for the time you spent here. When you go, we all have to go and stand in front of Allah. That time is the time that we will have. If we live our lives in this daze and shak and doubt and speculation, that, oh, I don't know these Maulvis, what these Maulvis are talking about, hadith, sahih, this, and doubt and speculation and suspicion about deen without, because deen is about yaqeen. These are the things, there must be things in your life that you have decided that, look, this, I cannot argue with this. This one, I have, I'm certain about this. Just as I'm certain that I will die, I'm certain that Allah will take me to task. I'm certain that I'm standing in front, certain in my mind that when I sit in tashahhud, I'm speaking to Allah. Because I know that when, if I live a life of shak, if I live my life in doubt, then I will die in doubt. And then when the angels ask, my answers will be in doubt. And this is exactly the description that we have in hadith, that when the angels will ask, Man Rabbuk, the person will say, well, I don't know, you know. And then what will happen? It's not a laughing matter there, because if you fail on the first hurdle, everything that comes after it is worse. But if you pass on the first hurdle, then everything else is better. May Allah grant us success at that moment, that our minds are, our mind and our heart is stable. It's firm on kalimat la ilaha illallah. That Allah is our creator. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is our prophet. And that Islam is our deen. Let us make that firm in our heart, so that we will be firm when we're questioned in the grave. And so that Allah can then say to the angels, open it, open the grave. Widen it as far as his eyes can see. And open the door so that he can see his place in Jannah. May Allah grant us this, and not make it such that it squeezes us and crush our ribs, that they go into each other and we are in trouble for eternity. May Allah protect us and guide us. Wajazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Tabarakallahu Rabbul Alamin.